Hello everybody, welcome. This is our third event of Female Ventures Eindhoven. Nice to see that again there are some different faces, so it's always nice to see that. Today's topic is climate change and sustainability. First, we do a small presentation on female ventures. That's done by me. I'm Jolanda Joling. I'm from Team Eindhoven Female Ventures. Then, Nadia Jululi-Guachati is doing presentation on BioMe. After that, there will be an interview of Ivona, my team member of Female Ventures. And she's doing an interview with Vera Hendricks of Dance Dutch Energy Solutions. And after that, Rosalie Fransen will take over and speak about the climate change policy of the gemeente Eindhoven. Female Ventures thinks that we should stop talking about all the challenges we meet, we face when working, being in business. We should have the conversation more and more of being, keeping the conversation being in business. So don't waste energy or time on the struggle or barriers, but more exchange knowledge and learn from each other. That's what we're doing here. And during this event, we will do the same. Why is Female Ventures there? It's there because only 7% of all the women are board members, or female board members is only 7%, which is extremely low. 35% is female co-founder, and we think we need support for men and women to change this. And yeah, this is a very new hot topic this week, as Technical University decided for the next coming 18 months to hire only women as professors. And I really support that. When I was younger, I didn't support that at all. I thought this is bullshit doing that. But now I think after a lot of research, which has been done, that it's not going fast enough, the change of having more women on higher positions. So we need to do something. We need to step out of comfort zone. And I think a technical university is doing a good thing, doing this. Why should we want more men and women involved with each other? A mix of both men and women improves the quality of decision making. Also, women have a positive impact on the company's performances, and women communicate differently, and we can learn from each other. Our philosophy is to empower learning and networking, inspire to connect to role models, and build cross-generation community. We have different teams. We have a team in Rotterdam, in Delft, in Amsterdam, Utrecht and Eindhoven. Our Eindhoven team consists of Marianne. Marianne, can you stand up that everybody sees you? She's the city coordinator of Eindhoven. We have Ivona sitting up front. We have Anna. And unfortunately, Malou could not be here today. She's also one of our members. She will be leaving our community because she's going for a scholarship in Sweden, so that's very good for her. So we have a vacancy of one of the younger ladies, preferably, because we like to have, of every generation, a team member, so we can learn from each other, the young and the old ones. We have an online community, Yeah, you all subscribe through our website. We are on LinkedIn. And here you see our founder. That's Duke Hoogland. Unfortunately, she could not be here, but probably next time she will be here, and then you will be able to meet her all. The agenda for the rest of the year, we have another two upcoming events, one 19 September and one 12 December. And we also want to have a workshop, which is called Boring to be Brilliant. So that's about presentation. And that will be in a different agenda. So we're not sure yet if you have ideas. Probably that one will not be for free, as it's going to be really a workshop where you can learn something. So share with us what you think about that later on. Success is not about how much money you make, but about the difference you make in people's lives. And now I would like to give the floor to Nadia.
Okay, Female Ventures, thank you for inviting me today here. I hope they asked me to talk about myself, who I am, and also to talk about the project BioMe, which I'm doing with a co-founder, Lydia Vrijen, and to tell also about something, because it's a topic which you can put in sustainability matters. And if I want to start about myself, well, I think when you're born, that's your start. And I was born in Morocco. I come originally from Morocco. And it was mostly near here, the Algerian border and the Mediterranean Sea. And nowadays, you can find me mostly in this area, on the Atlantic. And I really like in Morocco landscaping. I have a lot of passion for art, culture, and nature. And within that, also high tech and design. I came in 1988 to study at the TUE. that's to Eindhoven to study architecture and urbanism. And I felt something which I wanted to do for so long. I liked drawing, I liked mathematics, and to me it was very natural to come here to study architecture and urbanism. Something about myself in architecture is, I just show you a couple of images. Not that I'm going to really explain them, but the love of architecture. I do a lot of projects that are in housing and in developing areas in cities. So from time to time, I got these kind of projects in architecture. And in Eindhoven, something you can see where I have worked on with different people, but Bloemenbuurt Zuid, I don't know who knows it. It's a CPO project. It's like collective project for buyers, but also for people that hiring, that are renting. I'm sorry, I said hiring, but renting. And the Katterug on the Marconilaan. I was then just an assistant for Frank van Waas architectenbureau. So I do this kind of different projects. And in Amsterdam, since I come from the Mediterranean, they also ask me a lot about lifestyle of Mediterranean living. And at first, when they asked me, I said, yeah, I don't know. I was born there, but I haven't been there for so many years. So I don't know, but I was really interested in exploring what that could mean, the Mediterranean lifestyle. And to me, like I said, landscape and nature is so very important there. So I wanted to integrate that also in the philosophy of living and doing that in the best manner I could in a sustainable way. So this is a kind of project there. You see here that I already was busy with the how do you do it in a natural way, and then trying to find energy as an important thing. Could that be sustainable? Since a couple of years, if I describe myself, that art, culture, and nature, I try to do that also really in my daily life. And the nature, I find this a couple of years I'm doing in farming. I have my own olive yard, and I make my own olive oil. And you can learn a lot from these kind of things. And I really enjoy it because it's something, people say it's something different, but to me it isn't. It's all about the way you are positioning yourself in life, and it's a way of lifestyle. And these three things matter really to me. And they're connected, very connected to me. So here I'm trying to do the farming. And I'm doing it also in the best organic way I can. So, and accept that nature gives you, in a way, your benefits, in a way. So this is an olive oil I produce. So a bit about me. Then the project I'm doing and I'm going to present you is BioMe. And it started as a project after an open call of the gemeente Eindhoven. They had an open call which was called New Materials for the Future. And they asked designers, artists, do you have a project that is going to do something with this issue? And Lydia and I created BioMe, Share Nature's Vibe, because the both of us, we think ourselves are material fetishists. And we're teaching at Fontys Architecture School and at the TU. And we combined our passion in this project. And since Lydia was already very involved with biomimicry as a philosophy, we combined it in this project, and there also the name BioMe is coming from. We have in this project a couple of partners, which are Atos, Saxion Hogeschool, Fontys Hogeschool, and St. Lucas, as really partners in the project. And I'm going to explain later what they do. Cultuur Eindhoven as who subsidized the project a bit. And we have an advisory group because we thought it is better for us also to have a kind of feedback from different groups that could be interested in what we are doing and also be critical on what we do. So if you are doing your project yourself, you think it's okay, but the good questions come from different people. So we try to do that. And from Interface, Gianne van Arkel, Philips, Ingeborg Meiling, and Fontys, we have George Alvaslino. And from Biomimicry NL, Lilian van Daal is a designer, and Codrin Kreine is also very someone in the ECT business. Well, BioMe started, and I'm going to explain what and why we started it, how we do it, and who is involved, you already saw. What is BioMe about? It's we want through the philosophy of biomimicry, we want to create awareness and to have different stakeholders becoming familiar with this kind of philosophy, so that they can develop new sustainable innovations or products which are done with sustainable materials. And we do that through nanostructures. It's a bit, I think maybe it's difficult, but this is the way we saw we have chances here. And why we do it, we think we are very, how do you say, we find it very urgent in this moment of the world where everybody knows that we have huge problems about climate, and you can see it in every picture. There is a lot of environmental problems, but also the climate is heating up. So we know all these pictures are familiar to everybody, and we thought, what can we do? How can we contribute? So our purpose is, well, small ambition, to make the world better and healthier place. And I thought this remark of Leo Tolstoy was very important also, that everyone thinks of changing the world, but no one thinks of changing themselves. And I really think if you want to think about sustainability, it's all about our behavior also. So we hope by contributing in making people aware of some new technologies, ideas, to be more inspired by nature and to think of themselves as part of nature, not above it. So I don't know, who of you have ever heard of biomimicry? Okay, so that's more than half. And do you know also the book of Janine Benyus of Innovation Inspired by Nature? It's already from 1979, I think. 1997, and she was the first that really talked about this issue, and that you could apply lessons from nature to inventions of healthier and sustainable technologies for people. So, and she had a kind of principles where she said, in nature, it's always sustainable, and they do it with low energy, and there is efficiency to it, and we can learn from it more than we have done still. So there is a whole method of how you can try to apply this, and she calls biomimicry thinking, and you're scoping a problem and you look at it, discover what nature does to it, or how you can work with technologies that are inspired by what's done in nature. And then you can apply it to issues or design problems you have. So, well, not going to really explain everything about biomimicry, but she has a kind of principles, and there are some methods to it. I think this is one important that it's not only about design thinking, but going from design thinking to system thinking, and then go to ecosystem thinking. And it's, you apply these design thinking and system thinking within, but in a holistic strategy, and that gives you the ecosystem thinking. And we could learn from that to be more sustainable also. Die ga ik even overslaan. To give you some examples how products are developed inspired by nature and also by nanotechnology. There is an example of Lotusan, which is a paint. And a paint that has looked very well at how the waterlily, kom er even niet op. Huh? The lotus, because it's, yeah. Lotus, because it has also, it has capacity to be super hydrophobic. And when you look in the real structure of it, they can see now that how water is, how it is repellent to water. And they applied it also in a kind of paint so that buildings can stay longer clean. So you don't have to paint them every year, or you don't have to wash them every time to time. You can, and that's a kind of step in being more sustainable. You're not there yet, but it's a bit better than it was before. You have there is another example I can show you. This from Interface. They make carpet tiles, and they looked into nature to the gecko, which has capacity of walking with their feet on walls and etc. And they seem to have a really small hairs which give them this capacity. And they applied it to the way they put their carpets on the ground without using glue. And that helped them to be in their whole, and they apply the biomimicry system in their whole industry. They call it also factory as a forest. So they really look as to the forest as an ecosystem and apply it in all their chain. And that gives them a lot of reduction of polluting the environment. And the tiles are recycled, they can recycle them. So that's another example is Sharklet. Sharklet is a company that discovered a kind of film which is antibacterial, and they have they were inspired by the whale and the shark as a skin, and the skin of the shark has a lot of capacities, and one of them is antibacterial, and they applied it. So what you can see here is the way, if you look at the nanostructure of a shark, it seems like this. What they can make in industry is like this, and it's just one of the capacities of the skin. And they apply it now in hospitals, in areas where kitchens, where they should be antibacterial, etc. So they have really made it into a product. Biomimicry is not only about products, but also about services and systems. So you can apply it also to other things. Speedo is another example. They made swimsuits, so that they looked at the capacity of the skin that can go very fast through water, and they applied it in a way that their swimsuits could help you also be more faster in water. This is forbidden now in the ones that were winning were always the people that have these kind of swimsuits. So now forbidden. But so you can see this, and there is another one which is very inspiring. Is the high bullet train in Japan, and they were inspired by the bird, and because it can go faster, it uses less energy, and they solved a real big problem with noise. So a couple of these kind of how can you be inspired by nature? What we want to do is to visualize some things and to communicate about and make it accessible for people. So, and we do that about local bio-nanostructures. Why do we use bio-nanostructures? It is a technology nowadays which is giving us new information. Like Leonardo, he could look at birds and think about how he could fly. We can now with technology see more, which we couldn't before. And it gives new ideas about how to design for solutions we may have nowadays. So it's also about new technology. What we do, the process of biology, is we research natural nanostructures. We're going to map them, the technical and aesthetic aspects, because as designers we think also the aesthetic part is very important to us, just for the beauty. And we're going to, here you can see these kind of nanostructures. We want to make 3D printing out of them, because it's it seems to communicate very good with people what a nanostructure, how it looks like or what it can be. And we want to make an open data source about it so that the knowledge is really also shared. And we hope that different stakeholders can use this knowledge to develop new sustainable materials. And if you look at innovations, it's about 70% of all the innovations are about materials. So that's a very huge business. Here you see Lydia. And what we did in the process is we work also with biologists. We are architects. We don't know anything about biology, but we use a multidisciplinary team with all the knowledge we think we need, and we discuss all these things. They learn from us and we learn from them. And so we started with a literature study and the science of biology and biomimetic materials. And what we found is that a lot is about very chemical, and a lot is discussing also the medical part of it, because you see all these applications in medical science, but not to the natural part of it. It's more chemical. So from here, when we... Dit ging heel snel. Okay, sorry. We started to collect just plants in Eindhoven. Very simple. We started very simple. We went through Eindhoven, the area of the Genneper Parken, and we tried to collect these kind of plants. Just very simple. You can find them everywhere. And after collecting them, we described them. Where did we find them? How do they look like? A biologist has to do it in a kind of matter. And then it has to be identified, so the structures. And you can see that a plant has all, you have to describe the leaves, the structure it has, and there are a lot of levels. Even if you look at the left part or the right part or the back or the front, etc. So there is a lot of identification also in a plant and form. Here you see a bit about the nanometer, where we have, you can see, here you can see with an eye, you see your dog and these kind of things, and then you need kind of special microscopings, like light microscope or a scanning electron microscope or a transmission electron microscope to see these kind of measures in the nano. And here we have a first images of the light microscope, and we think already they're so beautiful in a way. So, but there is a very method in biology how they should be dried and how you keep them and etc. So that is done in a very scientific way, and then we have these images, and then you go to the SEM, and the SEM has really a lot of new information in it. So you see these kind of images. And they're very beautiful. If you, we couldn't see that by our, with our eyes. So, and it gives us all new information. And we thought if we see this, we know what to do. But that's not true. There's a lot of research still to be done. What the functional aspects are of these plants, what they can. And I write here 10, but it's not true. It's the AFM, and it's a microscoping that can. With a needle, can scan the height of the surfaces. And from there, we can go to 3D printing. And we have now to go from SEM to this procedure. So we told you already that all this knowledge, we want to have it in a database and to share it with others. And here we have Atos and Fontys ICT, who are thinking with us about that. And also, we've tried it first with the blockchain, exchanging the nanostructure with the blockchain. But that's a way of, not going to explain all about blockchain, but it's a way that it's decentralized security it gives you, and it's transparent. All these kind of matters are very important to it. And they have already gave us a mock-up, an idea, as an advice, how we could make such a nano box or nanostructure website where different kind of stakeholders, the creative industry, the business or researchers can enter, upload themselves information, but can also be inspired by the information and find there. So, and it's like a database where you can find all these kind of nanostructures. And then we hope for educational purpose also to make this kind of files, 3D printing, that everybody can also download and make them themselves and do with it what they want or want to learn from it. So, and now our biggest challenge from here is how we can get continuity after this year with funding, but also how do you tell this story in a good manner so that you reach also the stakeholders you really want to reach, and to understand what their questions are about or their needs in explore the idea of creating new sustainable materials. So that's where it's. This is our last or our how we want to continue. So this is the story I wanted to tell you. So that's.
Regards to funding, I think my voice is loud.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay.
I'm pretty loud. Yeah. Okay. I'll speak up.
Oh,
for the lights. Okay.
Sorry.
I'll speak down.
Yeah.
With regards to the funding, what exactly? Because if you want funding, then you have to define a very clear, like in one or two sentences, what your value proposition is and your unique selling point in the sense of. How is this different from all the research that's being done in material sciences and biomimicry around the world right now? How is this differentiating?
First of all, we want to apply biomimicry in it, the most information you find about nanostructures and so far is not biomimicry as a philosophy in it. And we want also to really connect the creative world with the researchers and with business, because what we learn is that a lot of scientists know where to find this and this and that, but it stays in their corner. And they're not discussing it a lot with creatives or other people. And we think that we can do some connection, more like inspire others to have multidisciplinary teams to accelerate innovation. We think that we really can help in that. And so that's one of the part that we think we are different, really different in. And open source.
Yeah. But why then do you do research yourself and don't you focus on making the platform, because I'm guessing there's a lot of biology research that is actually documenting these plants, and if it's about connecting, which I truly understand, then why not focus on that?
Well, I think you to us it's to go ourselves through a kind of process to understand what the difficulties are or how they really are made. You cannot think about something if you don't know how it's done, what the issues are, or how scientifically they are. Speak only to understand each other's language is already, a very important thing. So I think that is for us a kind of learning moment. It's not that we are going to do the research; we cannot do that, etc. Okay. But we try to understand and we try to get acquainted with the languages we all speak. So.
Yeah.
You can make a platform only if you understand also what has been spoken about.
Yeah, you need to know where the dots are to connect the dots.
Yeah,
right?
But we see a lot of chances
that
we think that could be interesting for sustainable design.
Yeah, definitely. Clear. Thanks. Yeah. Thanks for the answer.
Thank you for this inspiring presentation. You talk about sustainability. I was wondering if you also looked into the circular aspects, because in nature we find that. How with this research, if we can create materials that are easier for circular processes and circular economy? Did you look into that?
Yeah, we think if you apply really the philosophy of biomimicry, it's already circular. Because you have a lot of design approaches, And there are people that are talking about bio-inspired or biophilia, etc. But we think the highest ambition is if you really want to take it into sustainable and circular and energy efficient, then you should apply the biomimicry part. Because that is that you look at nature and the design process you go through or the solutions are within that idea. And nature is always circular. Nothing is going to be wasted. So I think that's the important part. Do you understand it, what I mean?
Yes.
Because
I always think also the technical part of it, in the sense like it could behave functionally like in nature. That I understand because you gave several examples. But what about it being also circular in the sense you can recycle? I'm wondering still about that.
Yeah. But we think if you we think if you apply it really in that sense, then it always is circular.
Okay.
There is no difference. We talked about the paint, and the paint is done also chemically. Not everything is biological. So that's why we say it should be biological, natural. So then it's always circular. But we cannot always be there in one time. So such a paint gives you helps you in being more sustainable, but it's not yet there as 100% also circular. So, and that's only if you can make it in a natural manner. So the biofilm of shark is really natural. No chemicals, nothing. It can be, and it's degradable. So. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Oh, you understand. Now I understand what you mean. Yeah, I understand. But that still, to me, is the how you try to apply everything. The ecosystem thinking is very important in that. And so if you do it like that, then you think, whatever I make, where I start, it has also has an impact and has to come back or has to...
Yeah. One more question. Last one.
So if I understood correctly, then you are creating a database and then you are inviting stakeholders to potentially commercialize the patterns that you researched and developed. So are there any examples where really somebody picked up a certain structure that you had in your database?
And not yet. We're still working on a...
So who would be then your target audience?
Well, we have a target at this moment is Mr. William Bartlett. He is a professor in Bonn, and he has already 220,000 nanostructures from plants. And he is the one also that has patent on the Salvinia or the lotus effect. So he has discovered how the lotus really worked, and they are applying it into businesses. And we hope that with these kind of stakeholders, we can share also the knowledge in a kind of way. So, but we're still working on this. It's really in this phase, we just had a mock-up, and we're doing that process to understand what is going around in this world. So we also, that's what I say, our challenge are our stakeholders also in the personas. What do they really need to accelerate innovation in this matter? Yeah.
Well, okay. Thank you. Again, a nice applause for Nadia.
Thank you for listening.
And Ivona, Vera, you're on now.
Good
we try not to fall.
Yeah.
It's a new experience for me on this chair. So my name is Ivona Skultatieva, and I'm a member of the Female Ventures team. And we thought, in order to a little bit change dynamics, we will do a short interview rather than just a talk. And then we go back to one more talk. And we saw that climate change and sustainability is a topic that is maybe surprisingly, maybe not, today carried by the youngest generation. I think in the past few months you've seen protests of teenagers who refuse to go to school because they really care about climate change and they feel that the current or the older generation doesn't really do a good service to this very, very important topic. So today I have also a representative of younger generation, not a teenager anymore. Not a protester, or no. Have I missed some? No. But our next guest, Vera Henriks, is involved in a groundbreaking startup called Dense that created a new type of fuel that is sustainable and will be sustainable even more in the future, as I understood. We would like to, through this interview, like give you more information on what Vera is involved in. So Vera, tell us. I think we have the. Yeah. It's hard to see because we need to check a presentation from the back. But tell us, Vera, what is the product? What is the innovative product that Dense developed?
So as a startup, we're working on a new fuel to supply energy wherever you want, without having the problems of CO2 emissions and depleting fossil fuels. So one of the things you can use is formic acid or hydrazine. Hydrazine is sustainably produced formic acid, and with that you can actually store hydrogen. So you see there on the picture, it looks like water. Does smell very differently. But you can just handle it like a liquid, so the handling is very easy. And what you do is then you break it up into CO2 and hydrogen, and then use that hydrogen in the fuel cell technology that already exists. And then you can use that energy wherever you like. So for the full circle, you see the following. So first you produce the hydrogen. That can be done sustainably. At the moment, it's still from fossil fuels. So this is something for the future to look into. But we're now making a product that transfers the formic acid back to energy. So then you get it to your site, and then you produce electricity, and then you emit again your CO2. So we do emit CO2, that's true. But you can use it again to produce new energy carrier. And so, in total, you have a circular path for your CO2. You don't emit extra CO2 into your into the atmosphere.
So that's what's called CO2 neutral.
Yeah,
right.
Exactly. And that is actually what we are doing. So we're now making a generator. Like this is a nice. It doesn't exist yet. So this is a nice render of what we're working on with the team. But with this, we hope to have sustainable energy at any location, at any time, present for everyone to use.
What are the potential future applications of this technology?
Yeah, for example, this generator, because it's easier also to handle than hydrogen or batteries, because it's less in weight, but also... For example, in heavy transport, batteries are too heavy. Hydrogen is too difficult to handle, and also the way to store it is very heavy still, although hydrogen itself is very light. So formic acid can be a good fuel there. And also in different... just to store energy, because hydrogen has a lot of disadvantages with leaking energy, because it's really hard to store. Formic acid is you just put it in a plastic container and you leave it, and then after 10 years you can use it again to make new energy without any leakage. So
I think not everybody knows that with renewable energy the problem is with the storage.
Yeah.
For instance, with solar panels, it is great source of energy, but it's very, very hard to store that energy. So this energy or this fuel is extremely easy to store and then use as a fuel whenever you want. So that's also one of the advantages. Vera, how did you get involved with such a project? Because you're still, we haven't mentioned that, but you're still a student at Technology University Eindhoven, but at the same time you're already working at a startup, so that's very, very new new approach that you are already involved in a very interesting project.
Yeah, so for me it all started with a student team. At the TUE, there are different teams that have been, started by students themselves on all kinds of technologies, for example, Team Fast, where we started this work on the generator, but also the solar car is one of the biggest examples, or the robots that play football. Everyone knows these examples, but we started Team Fast, and I joined them to make first a small car on formic acid, to show that it is possible to have a system on formic acid. And we continued with that, we made a larger generator, and some people of the team decided we want to continue with this. We want to start a company. To actually, with a student team, you can make the thing and show that it works. But you will not be able to make a huge impact anywhere because no one is using it yet. No one is buying it from you. So what we want to do is now to get it to the market so that people can start using this technology. So they started a company and they needed a chemical engineer and I was really still interested to join them and to help them out. I'm now doing that next to my master.
Why is it important for you to be involved in a project that is related to sustainability and contribution to climate change? And
For me it's both that you can make an impact. For me, chemical engineering is one of the things that has a really big impact on how the future will look like. Energy is made and transported with chemicals, oils or chemicals, electricity you make with chemicals, and also all the products we use, energy is used to produce them and chemicals are used to produce them. So we can make a big impact there. For me that's one of the reasons to join the team, to have this influence somewhere and to help out. Such a big problem.
Now, you are a real woman in tech, right? Because you are in a hard science and your field is hard science. So how did you get to chemical engineering, chemistry? And did you have somebody that inspired you or any impetus to go and study chemical engineering? Because we know that still the ratio of men and women in those fields, in those studies and subsequently also fields, is not that balanced.
No.
So
for me, that would be my mom. My mom also studied chemistry. So she always, from a small, young age, she already started showing me how, for example, soap works. Or we would make these volcano experiments in the kitchen. That made that I was not afraid of chemistry or anything. And also I am really intrigued in how all these things work and what you can do with them. So when I had to choose which bachelor to start, I ended up with the choice between physics and chemistry combines it all. So that's why I chose that, because actually I couldn't choose. and still, it's really nice. And also, but we are increasing with women in our studies. We are now 1/3
of women in your study.
Yeah, in chemistry.
That sounds very promising.
Yeah.
I think.
Nice. So it's really nice to
the numbers to be increasing.
Yeah.
So I don't think we have too many students at that age here, but it's also recorded and also streamlined. So what would be your message to girls that are deciding what to study and maybe thinking of chemical engineering or another hard science?
Just to figure out what gives you energy to do something, like where do you feel at home in. If that is not a hard study, then join that one. But chemistry is not scary at all. And as I said, it can make a big impact. So it's just forget about what people say you should do, because I mean, chemistry is just really exciting stuff to learn and to figure out how it all works. So why not figure out chemistry instead of some other kind of study? Yeah, let's just do what you like to do.
So exactly, do what you like to do, regardless of what your gender is. So.
Yeah.
With this message, I would like to finish this interview. If you have any questions to Vera, any questions so far? Yes.
Do you? You said you have a team of students. Are there from other faculties, so like physics, and is it multidisciplinary?
We're still with the company. We are still with many students, although we have also have some more experienced people, because only students doesn't work out in the end. But yeah, many mechanical engineers, because our core technology is chemical, but the whole system around it, to design that, you need a lot of mechanical engineers. Also someone from physics who is really interested in just how these systems work. Yeah, electrical engineering, programming, yeah, everyone actually.
It looks like a simple technique for me.
Yeah, it is.
How you explain it? Yeah. So why isn't it invented before?
No, because let's see, can I? Yeah. So the part in the orange box. You need a catalyst to do that. And this catalyst, a good catalyst, useful catalyst, has only been found a few years back.
Okay.
So before, it was not efficient enough to do this on a wide scale. But formic acid in literature has already been mentioned as a potential fuel in the 1970s. Yeah, so the idea is pretty old already, but
okay.
We were just not able to do it yet.
And there's enough formic acid in the world? Or?
Yeah, you can just produce... Yeah.
I don't know.
You can just produce it from water and CO2 and add electricity. And there's more to it, of course, but you don't need other stuff than that. And we can just get it... Yeah, water is available, I mean, to some extent. CO2 is also too much available. So, yeah, you can just... And you can make a cycle, so...
Great. Good luck.
Thank you.
Hey, I'm just curious. Are you already... did big companies like Shell already connect to you to see what's going on there in Eindhoven, like this little club of bright people inventing this new energy technology? And if so, how do you cope with that? I was wondering.
So, yeah, about all the sales stuff, I'm a bit more hazy because I focus on the engineering. But, we have large companies also interested in us. For Shell, I think we're still a bit too small. And also we try to steer away from them a bit. Just to not get... eaten up by them, and make sure that we know what happens to the technology and that it gets to the market, and not that they have like a nice idea and then it vanishes somewhere. That could happen. Maybe they will use it, but yeah, we want to have it to be sure that it is used. So, yeah.
So keep it pure.
Yeah.
Nice.
Answer already, but does the TU use your company, for example, to get the ID to the market? Of course, you need business, marketing, salespeople for that.
We are, like, they mostly now support on the chemistry part, actually. We have good connections with the Faculty of Chemical Engineering. They help a lot. And they also helped in the starting up of the business. From the student team to a business, we had some guidance as well. But we also have yeah, like if you get the networking. For me, I don't know how it all works, but there's someone looking into who can help us and what do we need. Okay. And yeah.
Last question.
So this formic acid is already produced. You start from the formic acid itself.
Yeah.
You don't, why don't you integrate the process of making formic acid out of electricity?
For us, we are now focusing on this because we have to start somewhere. We are too small team to also focus on producing the formic acid, although there are other people who are doing that. So we are looking into the whole chain to make that happen, but our technology, we only focus on building that machine.
Because, I can imagine that if you have a solution starting from a solar panel and then an integrated fuel.
Yeah, to produce it. Yeah,
to produce it and then bring back the electricity when you need it.
That's
I think the solution should be integrated.
That's the idea.
Yeah.
For now, there are other people more suited to look into that. For example, the TUE, I know someone who is going to start a PhD on that soon, actually, to produce formic acid sustainable and efficient.
Okay.
Because you can do it, but it's not that efficient yet.
No, that was the last question. So I would like to thank Vera for stopping by and hanging out with us. I think it was very informative, and I think you also people need to know more about amazing students and amazing startups that we have in the region, because sometimes it's really groundbreaking what these student teams can do. And then they push it further to commercialize their product. And it's really special, I think, because I'm also involved in startup community, so I'm a little bit biased, but I think they deserve more attention. So thank you very much. One big applause for Vera. And I give my word to Yolanda.
Yeah, who's handing over to Rosalie? Are you ready?
Ready. I'm inspired by the other two speakers, and I have a big bag. When something comes out, so let me see. This one. Everyone's looking now. Just before dinner, I thought, well, add some flavor to it. I like cooking. I like cooking curries, also Moroccan dishes. My husband is Moroccan, I went to my garden and picked some herbs also. So now my whole bag is smelling.
Smelling really nice. Because when I'm preparing this, I cannot do it with two hands together. Wait. Yeah, thanks. Yes, my name is Hansen. Thank you for inviting me to. I will tell you something from a global perspective of climate change how is Eindhoven coping with climate change and the extreme weather events we already face. I wanted to also challenge you, because I was challenged to do this within 20 minutes and then have 10 minutes discussion with you. So I also want to challenge you to think about what you could do about climate change. What could you contribute? So I had these flavors. They really smell nice. They do a lot in my kitchen. And I want to challenge you to pick one, choose one, and in the discussion, say why you choose one of these flavors and what you could contribute. Most of you are women and can multitask, so maybe you can fulfill this task. be creative, and I challenge you. You understand, or I need some more explanation? some people are looking, what is this? I work for Deltares. It's a knowledge institute who works globally on issues, water, soil, and infrastructure issues in deltas in the world. As you can see on the map, I will not explain all because we don't have time enough. But I can recommend you some series where a lady is going around the world and telling you about the effects, the impacts of climate change. It's called Waterlanders. For those who want to learn some Dutch, it's really recommended. We work on global challenges also, but I was asked to help the municipality of Eindhoven for 2 years. I was contracted here in the municipality. I'm also and I'm educated as a hydrologist, but also I studied public administration. And the municipality here was having was facing the problem how to with more extreme events like floods, droughts, and heat stress. So I was contracted to make some policy for the municipality. I will tell you something about this. So my profession is also analysis, planning, and implementation all in once, and then for the subject of climate change. Eindhoven. This would be the picture in 2050, maybe. More high buildings. As you know, perhaps 50%, half of the population in the world is living in urban areas. It's appealing to everybody, to younger generation, but to also it's economically benefits to live here. But how can we cope with growing population and also climate change, which is And is this a picture of Eindhoven more greener and more high buildings, which is true? Yeah, most people think so, and I hope so. Oh, it's working. this will show you some, this is the global temperature from 1900 till now, and it's increasing, just to show you that the global temperature is increasing quite fast. The Paris Agreement, where almost 200 countries signed for sustainable development goals. In the Paris Agreement, they said, well, we have to do something about climate change and also the impacts of climate change. We said together with all those countries, we have to stop this temperature rise. And it should not be at the tipping point of 2 degrees, and preferably 1.5 degrees. And it sounds like it's a little bit, but it's quite a lot for global temperature. And already we face a lot of extreme weather events with the temperature rise we have now. Can I? Good. Oh, yeah, this one. So the Sustainable Development Goal 13 is about the climate action, climate change and its impact. I will not tell you something about the mitigation part, there's not the energy part, the fossil fuels, but I will focus on the extreme weather events we face now already. As already have passed in the other presentations, the papers are full of extreme weather events. In Eindhoven and in the Netherlands, we face droughts, heat stress, and floods. Floods from heavy rainfall, but also from rivers. We live in a delta, and we want to live in a delta. And half of Netherlands is below sea level. In Eindhoven is above, but still we have problems here. So how to cope with it, and what is the impact on people, impact on vulnerable people, but also material, and also the mobility, for example.
You see some insects. The prediction is this will increase. Also, mosquitoes are already discovered in the Netherlands with viruses. So, well, it will be worse. The positive thing is you can choose and pick some flavor, and you can think about it yourself. Well, and the positive thing is some children like to play in the water in the summer. The temperature will be higher, and some people like it. Well, so there are also benefits. As we know, 3 weeks ago, the storm disaster, 800 trees have been down. Really disastrous. Yeah, and this is the central station area with heavy rainfall and with droughts. You see the tree there in the lower part. Well, this is a hotspot of the municipality, and it will be redesigned, and there will be more high buildings and everything. So, but now we face these problems. It's just small to see, but it's just how to show you that it also affects Eindhoven. And why does it affect Eindhoven? Just have a look at this picture. This is the municipality, the borders, and the this is from in the left corner. It's the year 1940, 1960 now, and you see urbanization coming. Eindhoven was first like 5-6 small villages in the 1900, and it grew, and urbanization is still growing. We have a lot of projects in Eindhoven going on. A lot of people want to live here, and in future we live now, I think, 220,000 inhabitants, and we go to 250,000 in 10 or 20 years. As you can see, this has impact on the physical system. There's no doubt about that. But how to cope with this? The positive thing also is we have green areas. And we like to let them stay green and also create more green in the area of in Eindhoven. The rivers in Eindhoven are connecting those green areas. It's the Dommel, the Gender, the Tongelreep, all those green parts. And as you can see, these are the levels of surface levels. The red parts near Flight Forum. This is the pointer. This one, Eindhoven Airport, Flight Forum, and this is the Dommel flowing through the city center. And as you can see in the lower parts, this is about 25 meters above sea level, and this is about zero. In this lower part, urbanization is high. This is the inner city, so it's not so practical that we have built here. But well, we did it in all the world. Globally, we are living in all those delta areas. There's water, and we need water. And that's the problem for the whole world and for all of us, but we have to cope with it. What we did to create some to develop a policy, we also analyzed where is flooding in Eindhoven, where are the hotspots, and where are the hotspots for heat stress. On the right, you see. You see the inner city. It's purple. The Hurrik, it's the industrial areas. Are purple. Those are paved, so it's all stones, no green, nothing, and it's quite hot. And it will be hotter. It will be purple. It will be more than 10 degrees rise more than 10 degrees if we do nothing. So this is a picture for 2050. So those are hotspots where we could do something. Those are hotspots of flooding areas. So we calculated some scenarios, and you see some hotspots where we should do something now. And for all the city, we have to create also more water storage. There's a lot of research going on. I will not explain the whole visual. I think every arrow has, I think, more than a meter research reports. So, well, there's a lot of research going on, and we know a lot, but still, it's the challenge to combine this all in a strategy for the municipality to cope with it. The best roof is a green roof. Climate-proof green roof with solar panels. In the municipality behind, the Stadskantoor, there is a consortium of partners thinking of how to make a sustainable roof there now. So it should be nice. Green and with a rooftop terrace. The policy process I worked on started with a climate ordinance, also mitigation and adaptation, the adaptation part I worked on, and it resulted in a climate plan, and there is also a green plan. Yeah. After that, we made it in more detail, the strategies we made more in detail in plans, but also in regulation. So we started from above in 2016, with a nice and afterwards we are working on the regulation also for building new projects in Eindhoven that they have regulation also for water storage, for example. It was a whole process. It's not that easy. The ambition and climate to be a climate resilient Eindhoven was also written down, and Eindhoven is working on a climate resilient city for themselves, for the municipality, so that people work climate resilient. And in 2050, the city of Eindhoven will be climate resilient. The municipality cannot do this alone because 70% of the property in Eindhoven is private. So there are a lot of stakeholders, housing corporations, but also the citizens who have to do something to cope with this problem. We defined it as coping with heat stress and floods and droughts. And this gives a little bit answer also on your question. We say that to store the raindrop as much as possible on the place it falls, because the soil has like a structure that it has to absorb. And as you could see, the urbanization is going on. There are more buildings, more pavements, and the water cannot come into the soil. So that's the problem. So we are working on more green so that water can infiltrate. The other thing is no passing on to neighbors in lower areas. So as you can see, there's in levels in Eindhoven, and everybody has to work on it. So like everybody in the lower parts can have to do something, but also on the upper parts. So also Eindhoven Airport has to plant some trees, maybe. No, you never know. Maybe a sand airport. Now, and then stimulate green measures because of so many benefits. So that's green roofs, but also green in your gardens. And also like the inner city, there's a big project going on. The red stones in the inner city are going away, and more green is coming. I hope more green is coming, so really vote to what municipality is doing. They looked really great. I was a little bit disappointed, yeah. But we can do something about it. Fill in the app. Infiltrate rainwater. We have got like three golden rules, which are in policy and also in regulation. These golden rules are now in text, but we have them like in millimeters per second and how many rain you should stop when you start a project or build something in Eindhoven. And that's really unique for that we have now regulation for new projects. It's you have to store 60 millimeters
of water, rainfall water, and when you build a new project. And it doesn't say much to you, maybe, but it's unique that it's also implemented in regulation now. For example, Amsterdam has it already for the Zuidas, only one area, but we have it for the whole municipality by 2020. The challenge is also to integrate functions. As you can see, here is a tree. It has roots, so it needs space. But you also want to park your car behind in the city center near the blob, how it's called, blob. We need infrastructure, we need a lot, so it's a challenge to integrate. And so we know with all project leaders to make this policy and to get it implemented within the municipality. We learned from pilots in industrial areas, Flight Forum, but also in the city. Geesterberg was a project, and also Stripe S, to learn what measures could we do and what, how does it affect on soil and water, and flood and droughts. This is an example of restoring the gender. It's Gender. It's a small river. It's now underneath this green park now, Victoria Park. It's this is the PSV Stadion. And here will flow in, I think, in 5 years. There will flow the gender again. It's flowing now under the ground until the central station. There it will come up again, because it cannot flow through the, what is called, 18 September plein. It's not possible, so it's coming there. And that's also a measurement where rainwater can just again infiltrate and the space. So there's also a hype, a pavement hype, to turn your garden into grey, unfortunately. So the municipality is working very hard to get people to communicate and to create awareness. And I saw in this pet book that Dutch people are really good in growing plants, easy and healthy. I thought, they see something what I don't see. But well, we're working on it, so it's really important. And it's really important to create awareness, but it's really difficult because everybody has other thoughts about your garden. It's your private property, and nobody should say what to do with it. But there are also good examples. We have a lot of projects with together with neighborhoods, streets, who are making the streets sustainable, and there's also subsidy for this. You can find more information if you want to know something more on the website of the municipality, on measures you can do yourself. It's Eindhoven. Duurzaam. Whatever. It's a website. You will send the presentation also to everybody of now. eindhovenduurzaam.nl/climate. So you can find everything there. And there's also a sort of calculation tool for designers, architects in the city who want to have a project which is, and if they want to have an vergunning, what is vergunning? A license, yeah. You have to do this calculation of water storage also. And it's quite it's a calculation which is also stimulates the green measures. So if you have green measures, you have to, you will get points, and it's better. There's also a monitor for the city to see how we cope with climate change, because it's not like a 1 year project. It's 20 years you have to think of. And I will skip this because it is in Dutch. But if you want to have some Dutch, well, just have a look at it. It's about what do about mitigation and adaptation, climate adaptation. It's about solar panels and everything. So this is Eindhoven Brainport in the region, connecting to the western Western Netherlands and also to Germany. We are thinking here in Brainport to make a connection to Düsseldorf, also Brussels. It's high, like you saw, its urbanization is growing, and economically this region is also growing. The strategy of the municipality and the policy is one thing, and it's a good thing, but we still have to think together with each other, together with all stakeholders, how we can cope with climate change. And that's the question I had in the beginning. I think everybody has chosen a flavor. And the pepper is also is also chosen. So how small changes can have a global impact? I had some impact, I think, with 2 years working on the municipality, from making policy to regulation. Nobody, not everybody in the Eindhoven will be glad with this, but I think the climate, our globe will be glad with this. It's a big issue, climate. I think like it's like the big elephant. It's our Earth, and we are just like the small mouse. It's staring at it. What can I do? What can I do? But please don't go, Earth. And we can do something if we are. We can love this elephant, for example. So, yeah, I was curious. What could you do?
Yeah, I chose the rosemary, and I chose it because actually plants emit VOCs. These are chemicals that are that let plants communicate with each other, and these chemicals can potentially be healing for humans also, and we can design spaces through these chemicals in which we can heal. So I have this vision on creating healing spaces that are like preventive for human health instead of like post. If you're already sick, you end up in a hospital like it is now. Mm-hmm. And I think we need in the future to this place in which everything is a healing space, also our working environment. So now I am starting to create, or we are actually looking for how we can develop this healing space with like different future designers in Eindhoven, and that can also be very interesting working space, for example, with a conference room with Mint, and you can only enter this conference room twice a week because the rest of the week the Mint plant has to rest. And this is done so that you can really experience the plant. So
when are you going to start this project?
Last Friday, 10 days ago,
really?
I had this experimental meeting with a chef here in Eindhoven, and it was really surprising for me also because he resonated really with this idea, and I was like, okay, maybe now is the. So if anyone feels like, oh my god, sounds interesting, talk to me, and I'm like really starting this initiative. So maybe in a year we are somewhere. Yeah. Like physically, now it's just an idea starting from the rosemary.
Nice. I can connect you to somebody from the greenery, from the municipality, if you like. Okay. Because there are coming more green areas. So nice. Thank you.
Yeah, so it's about what we're doing, right?
It's about, sorry?
What we're doing for basically the energy
you,
transition.
You, not we, you.
Oh, okay. I talk in we usually because there's a team behind me. But it's with Fruit Punch AI, we're working on actually like how artificial intelligence can facilitate the energy transition. And this is in three parts. So it's in optimizing the production, the distribution, and the use of energy, right? So it's very broad. Like we're very used to looking at a lot of problems in terms of in Eindhoven as well. Like we have energy and we have mobility, right? But actually the logistics behind transport, the second biggest user of energy in the world, can cut down on energy use for 40% if we can optimize the transport. And this is an artificial intelligence problem. So this is, I'm just like highlighting one thing, but in that sense, optimization is essentially something that can reduce our use of energy up to 70%. So that's what we're doing.
Nice. And can it also increase the motivation of citizens to do green the garden?
Possibly. I wouldn't focus on it because I think 70% reduction of the total energy use is going to be more impactful than trying to predict the social patterns of people, which artificial intelligence hasn't really proven itself in up until now.
Yeah, okay. We'll discuss this during dinner. Maybe. I think everything helps. That's true. Doesn't mean that we can do. Yeah, we do what we. If we do what we did, we. How is the coin? If we do what we did, we get what we get. Get what we always got. So then we. Yeah. There's not going to be change. Yeah. Okay. That's great. Yeah. Somebody,
I have the mic, and I chose this green leaf. It's I think coriander, and
if you no, it's the maggi.
Oh, I don't know. That, okay, it's a different one. But I chose it because it is green, mm-hmm. And secondly, I like to share my resources. So I only took a small part of the branch. So that other people could have something left. So that is something good to do. Share your resources. That's one lesson. And secondly, I love to cook vegetarian dishes. And I'm teaching. I'm doing it small scale. I don't have a big initiative. But I like to cook fish or vegetable dishes. And I talk about the topic about cutting out meat in one's diet. Because with that, we don't use as much water. It's the to be with, and they need a lot of space. It's quite an in read about. So I am talking about this on a small scale with my family and friends. Nice. So that's
thanks. Yeah.
Hi, I work for a global firm, and one of the things that I do is analyze brands that we buy and see whether we can not break glasses but exploit the economies of scale to make things more efficient. However, the plant that I picked was saffron. It's very interesting because it's incredibly expensive, and I think it's even more expensive than gold per gram. And the reason it is so is that it's so it's grown from the crocus plant, and it's really labor intensive to farm. And one of the things we have to take care of in our roles is to make sure that we don't spoil these ecosystems around the world in developing countries as well. The countries that farm saffron. So I just wanted to raise that point and say that it's not only about globalizing things, but also leaving them local where it makes sense.
Yeah. Thank you.
Hello. I picked this seed. I don't even know what it is. Oh, it's nutmeg. Okay, I actually really like nutmeg. It's good.
You can smash it and then smell it. But I forgot the name. It's the Indian. How do you say? I forgot. But it's not.
Yeah.
Somebody else has maybe the nutmeg. It's with the white.
Still, I pick it because I like that it's a seed. And that is actually how I see myself right now and how I see my goal in life. I am a lawyer. I have a master in international law and human rights with a specialization in environmental law. And I do want to dedicate my life to work in human rights advocacy and in environmental law advocacy because I feel that these two fields are deeply connected. We cannot have a conversation about human rights if we don't take into account all these climate and environmental situations. And one of my life goals is precisely to raise awareness. I do feel that we have all these problems right now because there's a lot of people who doesn't really know. I think we need to have more conversations about climate, about environment, and about wildlife if we really want to make a difference. And so, yeah, that's one of my goals, raise awareness, education, and advocacy in this field.
Thank you. Nice. Thank you. One more person? The pepper. I use pepper because I love spicy food. Yes, it still works. Spicy food is actually very functional in areas which are extremely hot because it helps to disinfect the digestion of people who live in those areas where, let's say, the food goes bad really, really quickly. So it is a very functional, not just tasteful, but also functional spice. The question what I'm doing to towards sustainability, I was looking at the garden that you showed and all the, let's say, concrete gardens that we see. This is exactly what my garden does not look like. So I have full vegetable garden with all the spices that are available on the market. So my neighbors have exactly that concrete garden, and I think it's crazy. I think my neighbors are not here, no. And then I also have a relatively new house with solar panels. And you cannot imagine what my satisfaction is at the end of the month when I get the bill. And it actually says minus amount because I delivered to the network more than I consumed in terms of energy. So I really had a lot of satisfaction from that. But those are just small steps. And I have maybe question related to it. So even if all of us do everything sustainable possible, there is still 50% of energy or maybe more than that is consumed by industry. Mm-hmm. If we change, but they don't, does it make sense for us to do all that? That's what's occupying my mind a lot.
Yes, that's a good question. I think both has to do, but if we don't, at the end, we also work at those industries. At the end, we are the consumers of also meat and everything, and we are the consumers of non-organic food in supermarkets, which is low price, but, well, not quality, not sustainable. So at the end, we are the ones who can make a difference. And that's not, yeah, you can always point to industry, it's true, like Airport Eindhoven, it's a big issue. Will it grow, will it not grow, and how do they innovate with not fossil fuels but electricity? It's a big question, but it doesn't, it starts with yourself.
I believe it too. I just wanted to be a devil's advocate for a bit.
I think that was the last question.
Oh, amen. Yeah, I'm a believer.
Okay, I haven't chosen a herb, but I totally agree with you. I think you are already a big inspiration for other people because you have solar panels and your neighbors will notice. And probably they will also notice your green garden.
And so I think with our purpose, we can inspire others and create a ripple effect. And that is also what I want to do with my company. I will start the 1st of July, also a new job to create my purpose, to contribute sustainable, because I will be advising on energy innovation. And next to that, where I also want to inspire other people to find a job with purpose where they can be to be fulfilled in their lives.
Nice, thank you. And I also think maybe what the last thing I can say, but I think it's really nice that there are the full the people, like 40, 50 people here sitting. I think 10 years ago it wasn't like this. I think there's people have growing awareness about sustainability, and that's, for me, it's a positive trend, hype. So we're going the good, the right way. Yeah.
Thank you. You wanted to tell something. Is it first me? First applause. Rosalind, thank you for your inspiration. Very nice. I want to like to thank the speakers of today, Rosalie, Nadia, and Vera. Will you come forward, please? Because we have some small nice thing for you. Our flower boy is again available today. Thank you. And we all would like to invite you, because we don't do a break, we do the networking always afterwards to save some time, going up and forth. So please do not go yet, and we continue our conversation. And if you want to join for dinner, you're also welcome to do that. That's not for free, it's around 70 euro, but then you can just address to the bar, I think, and say if you want to join, then we can have some more discussion about sustainability and climate change if you want. And hopefully the speakers will join us too.
Yes.
Thank you. And hope to see you next time on September the 12th. And you wanted to say something.
Hi guys, I'm Margot from the Innovation Cafe. Just so you know, Female Ventures is always at the Innovation Cafe, but we're here actually every week. So please feel free to go to the website as well. Robert, could you maybe show like the slide as well? Yep, great. So we do this together with a lot of partners. Female Ventures is one of them. But we, like I said, we're here every Thursday from 5:30 on. And as Yolanda already mentioned, there's a dinner afterwards. It's also every week. It's a meetup table, so you can join the speakers. She said, so it's a meat, fish, or vegetarian dish. It could also be vegan. Meat and fish for €17.50 and a vegetarian dish for €15. So if you want to join, just let me or someone at the bar know. Yep. And hope to see you again next week.